In the beginning, there was only one type of force. With the Big Bang, the forces were divided. Modern physics discovered four fundamental forces of nature: gravity, electromagnetic force, strong nuclear force, and weak nuclear force. Here is Earth. The Moon revolves around the Earth. This is the mass of Earth. This is the mass of the Moon. What happens when we measure their mass together? Will it be the sum of each of their masses? No, it is not. The combined mass of Earth and the Moon is smaller than the sum of each of the masses. But why? There is a bonding energy between the Moon and Earth. Gravity. According to Einstein's special theory of relativity, mass can become energy and vice versa. This means that invisible energy can become visible matter, and that matter can become energy. Coming back, the gravitational pull between the Moon and Earth can become mass. If we pull the Moon infinitely far away from Earth, the gravity between them disappears. Does this mean that this energy is also gone? No, it is not. The bonding energy between the two are converted to mass. Thus, each of their masses are bigger when they are apart than when they are bound with gravity. The sum of Earth's mass and the mass of the Moon equals the combined mass of Earth and the Moon plus the bonding energy between the two. Gravity is weak when compared to the other forces. Therefore, even when gravity is converted to mass, the difference is ignorable, compared to the original mass of either the Moon or Earth. However, the difference becomes harder to ignore as the scale becomes smaller. The mass of this atom is smaller than the sum of the mass of its nucleus and electrons. This is because mass corresponding to the electromagnetic force between them was converted to energy. If we compare gravity and electromagnetic force, the latter is much stronger, about 4 times 10 to the 42 square power. Therefore, bonding energy created by electromagnetic force is much stronger than one created by gravity. However, an even stronger force than electromagnetic force exists. It is strong nuclear force. Strong nuclear force acts within the atomic nucleus. Protons repel each other due to electromagnetically. However, if we had sufficient energy in a high-pressure, high-temperature environment, they overcome the repulsion and form a bond. The force that mediates this bond is called strong nuclear force. This force is strong enough to overcome electromagnetic force, but only works at a short distance, that is, a distance short enough for two protons to stick together. The nucleus consists of nucleons such as protons and neutrons. These nucleons are bound together with strong nuclear force. The mass of the bound nucleons is bigger than the sum of each separate nucleon. This is because the bonding energy between the nucleons are converted from mass. This graph shows the bonding energy per nucleon and the number of nucleons. Bonding energy per nucleon means the bonding energy of each nucleon. For example, if the nucleon number of element X is 100 and the bonding energy of its nucleus is 300, the bonding energy per nucleon is 3. The element with the biggest bonding energy per nucleon is iron. The higher this number, the more stable it is. Iron is the most stable element in nature, and other elements want to become as stable as iron. Elements with fewer nucleons than iron want to be stable through fusion. Elements with more nucleons than iron tend to go through fission to become stable. These processes are nuclear fusion and fission. Both nuclear fusion and fission try to become stable through a process of increasing bonding energy. To summarize, elements with fewer nucleons than iron, hydrogen, for example, increase their bonding energy as their nucleons go through fusion. While elements like uranium, which have more nucleons than iron, increase their bonding energy through fission. When nuclear fusion occurs, bonding energy increases this much. And nucleons go through a loss of mass corresponding to this energy. In nuclear fission, the bonding energy per nucleon also increases. But the increase is not as big. And the split elements lose mass corresponding to this energy. You might have not been able to absorb all of this. What's important is that regardless of whether it is nuclear fusion or fission, nucleons lose mass in the process. And the energy released is a result of this lost mass. We can notice that the amount of energy released is much greater in nuclear fusion. Here's uranium. Uranium is an element with large amount of atomic weight and is easily found relatively in nature. The element number of uranium is 92, which means that its number of protons are 92. There are uranium-235 and uranium-238, and the numbers represent the sum of number of protons and neutrons in the nuclear. Uranium-235 has 92 protons and 143 neutrons, while uranium-238 has the same number of protons at 92, but 146 neutrons. Element that has the same number of protons, but different number of neutrons, just like the case above, is called an isotope. Uranium-238 is more stable than uranium-235. Uranium-235 tends to have higher tendency to split in instability. Most uranium exists in stable 238 form, and there is only 0.7% of natural uranium-235. The uranium-235 with 2.4% concentration of 235U is called low-enriched uranium, while one with 90% concentration level is called high-enriched uranium. Low-enriched uranium is used for nuclear energy generation, and high-enriched uranium is used to create nuclear bombs. Now, let's find out how uranium is used in nuclear bombs. When you add a neutron to the nucleus of an atom of uranium-235, the nuclear splits into barium and krypton. In this process, three neutrons and energy occur. The sum of mass of neutron and uranium-235 before the split is not on par with the sum of barium, krypton and three neutrons, because the mass decreases after the split. The loss of such mass can be seen in a graph depicting bond energy per nucleon. As the number of nucleons reduces after split of uranium, bond energy of nucleons increases. Mass in turn reduces by the amount such bond energy increases. The lost mass here is released as energy. Protons cause nuclear split as they crash the nuclear of uranium. And the neutrons released from the process split up other nuclears. The chain reaction involved releases massive energy. In order to maintain such chain reaction, you need minimal level of mass, and it is called a critical mass. When uranium-235 is concentrated to 93% level, it needs at least 52 kilograms of mass to maintain the chain reaction. When you split the uranium into two and put them together again, its mass exceeds that of the critical mass and explodes, which we called a nuclear bomb. Little boy, the first nuclear bomb to be used in practice used this very principle. Now, let's look at hydrogen bomb. A hydrogen bomb is a more advanced form of weapon than nuclear bomb and is more complicated. It uses energy released in the process of turning hydrogen into helium through fusion. Hydrogen is an element with one proton and one electron. Isotopes of hydrogen include heavy hydrogen with one proton and one neutron and tritium with one proton and two neutrons. When you fuse heavy hydrogen and tritium, you get helium and energy is released from one neutron. When the element turns to helium, the bond energy per nucleon increases. The mass in turn reduces by the amount energy increased, and the reduced mass releases energy. Now, energy amplifies in bigger volume in a nuclear fusion than in nuclear split. However, you need great level of temperature and pressure to create a nuclear fusion, and you create such environment using a nuclear bomb. Inside a hydrogen bomb, there is a bomb in the upper tray that creates a nuclear split, while in the lower tray, you have a bomb that creates a nuclear fusion. Inside the bomb leading to a nuclear split, there is either uranium or plutonium in the form of a ball. Then the surface is surrounded by general bombs. The bomb on the lower tray leading to nuclear fusion is made from an uranium case, and inside of it is lithium deuteride, and in the center is plutonium. Lithium deuteride is a compound combining lithium and heavy hydrogen, and is a material in powder form that is in a stable status. Hydrogen as liquid requires cooling facilities and therefore becomes bulky, so it is not quite adequate for use in practice. Unlike heavy hydrogen readily found in seawater, tritium is extremely rare in nature, so use of it had been an issue as well. Therefore, scientists found a way to produce tritium inside the bomb, and started to use solid lithium deuteride. When lithium deuteride receives a shock on its neutrons in high temperature, helium and heavy hydrogen, tritium are created, and the heavy hydrogen and tritium formed make nuclear fusion reactions. The surface of the bomb is covered in styrofoam, so the entirety of the surface is resistant to heat and is full of beryllium, which has high reflexibility. If an explosive explodes, uranium or plutonium is compressed in a supercritical status. Then begins a nuclear split, and high-energy gamma rays and X-rays that release heat are emitted. The energy is redirected from the surface of the bomb to the inside of the bomb, and gets concentrated on the nuclear fusion bomb. The energy turns styrofoam into a plasma, and compresses the bomb so that the heat and the pressure of the plasma can react with the lithium deuteride. Lithium deuteride split into helium, heavy hydrogen, and tritium. And the heavy hydrogen and tritium fuse together to form helium, during which process energy is released. The protons created from the process causes nuclear split of plutonium inside and uranium on the outside to put more pressure both inside and out. The great heat and pressure found in this process expedite more nuclear fusion to occur. As all these processes occur in the speed of light, a massive explosion occurs in a very short period of time, that is, less than a second.